There are many kinds of science fiction. There's what's called space opera, that is mainly about spaceships, the many crew members who fly and maintain them, and the numerous worlds that the latter visit. This includes Star Wars, Star Trek, and Warhammer 40,000, the last of which I already talked about in a previous video. Then there's speculative fiction that discusses strange topics like alternate history wherein things turned out different, such as what if the Americans didn't join World War II, or if the Russians were the first to set foot on the moon. The book series Leviathan, written by Scott Westerfeld, and the Assassin's Creed games number among the examples of this. Then you have what's called cyberpunk, which is about how technology comes to dominate society itself and showcases its negative effect on the people that live in said society. As an example of this genre, you have the books written by William Gibson, films like Blade Runner, and of course, the games Cyberpunk and Shadowrun. Hi, hello, and welcome! This is me, Natural Juan again, here to introduce you all to the world of Shadowrun. I mean, I'll probably make a video for Cyberpunk later on, but right now, Shadowrun is all I have prepared. Specifically, a broad intro into the 5th edition. So without further ado, let's get running. Shadowrun was originally a product of FASA, the same people who made the all-popular mecha game Battletech, but later handed it over to Catalyst, who also went on to take their other intellectual properties, including Battletech. Now, Shadowrun is unique in its genre as, while it is mainly sold as a cyberpunk game, it also has many elements of a fantasy setting, such as having fantastical races such as dwarves, elves, orcs, and trolls. There is even a supplemental book that I'll probably discuss in another video eventually that is almost completely high fantasy and eschews its science fiction elements. This has led to an interesting response from players of the game, with some choosing to play a full cyberpunk game without even mentioning the game's fantasy elements. Then you have the other extreme where players choose to leave out the game's cyberpunk elements, and which was probably what led to the creation of the supplemental book mentioned above. Anyway, Shadowrun takes place in our world, or at least an alternate version of it that is very similar. The story deviates slightly in terms of history, as somewhere before the 2000s, the world's governments declared bankruptcy and handed over their authority to several, at least 10, very large mega corporations. However, the fun doesn't stop there as, when the calendar hits the year 2000, a number of world-shattering events occur. First, a dragon awakens and goes on a rampage, destroying cities and killing a lot of people. Then, a comet streaks over the sky and women give birth to strange creatures which can be barely called human at all. Last but certainly not least, magic seems to have returned to the world and people soon discover that they have somehow gained mystical powers. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is just the beginning. This is probably one of the weirdest but also potentially coolest settings I have ever encountered. This is a setting where cyborgs, fully automated combat drones, and independently functioning artificial intelligences live alongside wizards, elves, orcs, and other great legends. But while this may seem cool and all, I need to stress that the Shadowrun world is far from ideal. In fact, it's probably one of the most dystopian places I've ever read about. The world is now ruled by utterly massive and tyrannical corporations that seek nothing but to bring the common people to their knees. Without the protection of governments, people's liberties have become a thing of the past. Only the large corporations, called megacorporations or megacorps, and a person standing with them is what matters. This is a setting where, if you don't have any clout with a given megacorp, you can't expect much from them. Worse, if you are neither an employee or customer of one of the big megacorps, you're pretty much screwed. If you've read from the Bible, it's a lot like that part in Revelations where you can't purchase or sell anything legally without the mark of the beast. And to think several of the megacorps in this game is run and managed by dragons. Yes, I mean that literally. Dragons. Since Shadowrun takes place in a setting that's a lot like our own world, a lot of the brands, companies, and individuals are pretty much the same. That said, some major changes include, but are not limited to, the United States becoming divided into several groups of states, with one of them being comprised of communities ruled by Native Americans. Japan has gone back to its imperialistic ways and conquered, or rather reconquered, parts of Southeast Asia, including the Philippines, and yes, they're as horrible as ever. Much of Eastern Europe, especially Russia, has been devastated by war, and there's no sign of it slowing down anytime soon. The list goes on. Now, as for the gameplay, the game is played using a dice pool system, or, to put it simply, lots and lots of dice. The traditional and most recognizable D6, or six-sided dice, as a matter of fact. I heard that the latest edition of Shadowrun now uses D10s, or 10-sided dice, but we're only discussing 5th edition right now. Anyway, the game works as follows. So, the only important numbers on your dice are 5 and 6. Whenever you roll a 5 or 6, you have made a hit, or success. The other most important number in your dice pool is 1. 1 signifies failure. For instance, your character is using the computer skill, which requires you to roll 5 six-sided dice, and the difficulty is 2. This means that if you at least roll 2 fives, 2 sixes, or 1 5 and 1 6, you succeed in your task. Rolling less than that would mean failure. However, should you have the misfortune of rolling nothing but 1, meaning all the dice show 1, this means that you have glitched and have failed catastrophically. This could signify that you have accessed something you are not supposed to and are now declared a criminal, with the corporate police fast on the way to your location. The other is that you have accidentally set off a self-destruct mechanism, and that the building you are in and its immediate surroundings are set to explode in the next 10 seconds. Once you've selected a GM to prepare your game for you, then it's time to create a character of your own. You should start with a good concept, whether it be a super strong bodyguard type, a sneaky thief, a powerful modern or futuristic magician, or a person who uses robots to fight for them. Then it's time to choose a meta type, which is similar or even identical to the concept of race in other games. In the core rulebook, you have the option to choose an elf, dwarf, orc, troll, or garden variety human. Each metatype has its respective strengths and weaknesses, although they can be built in ways to overcome their weaknesses. These 5, by far, are not the only metatype options available, and several other supplementary books introduce new ones you can play as, which I will detail in later videos. Anyway, once you've selected a metatype, it's time to choose an archetype. The most common archetypes include the street samurai, the shaman, the decker, the technomancer, the adept, the face, and the rigger. The street samurai is your basic fighter who's skilled in a variety of weapons from firearms to, yes, swords. The shaman is essentially a magician who specializes in summoning, communicating with, and controlling spirits. The decker is your futuristic hacker since, in this setting, the internet has become something else entirely. Then you've got the technomancer, who can control machines with their magical powers. The adept is another magician, but is less concerned about summoning spirits and more about using destructive magic directly. The face is the guy who serves as a group's front, and is the one present to cut deals and is usually the guy who knows a guy. Finally, the rigger is the guy who's the expert in all sorts of machines, be it the various vehicles found in the game, to the many drones that can be controlled or commanded remotely. Alternatively, you can eschew an archetype altogether and create a character from scratch. Yes, you heard that right. Unlike class-based games like Dungeons & Dragons or Pathfinder, you can combine traits from one archetype to another provided it meets a GM's requirements. You can have a rigger who's also good at fighting with a sword, a shaman with good social skills, or a decker who's a crack shot with a pistol. And, I bet, you can come up with your own ideas in combining traits to make a character of your own. So, once you have your Shadowrunner character ready, it's time to get going on your first run. First, you have to meet with a Mr. Johnson. Mr. Johnson is the term used in this turbulent era to refer to the people who are willing to pay to get something done. They can be anyone, in fact, and they don't need to be a Mr., nor do they all have to be named Johnson. In fact, you can expect some of them to be using a completely different identity to avoid being discovered by the local corporate police. Sometimes, all they want done is a little corporate sabotage. Other times, they want information. Then there are those times when they need someone geeked. And this is when things get really interesting. So that's it for this intro on Shadowrun. In later videos, I'll be showcasing the major and a few minor megacorps in the setting, the different meta types players can use, the various challenges Shadowrunners face, and so much more. Again, this is Natural Juan bidding you all a good day. If you like this video, please feel free to like and share and subscribe to my channel. So stay tuned, stay safe, and God bless everyone.